A big new entry as of this second. New Jersey Senator Cory Booker is making it official. He is running for president.
We want to go straight to CNN's Rebecca Buck, who is live near Booker's home in Newark, New Jersey, with more on these breaking details. Rebecca?
That's right. We're here in Newark, the city that launched Cory Booker's career as mayor some years ago. Today, as he takes that next big step to run for president. And he picked a symbolic day to do it. This is the first day of Black History Month. Booker is the second African-American candidate to jump into this Democratic primary after Senator Kamala Harris. And he is putting that heritage front and center in this race, not only because he will be targeting African-American voters, but because it is a key part of his own personal story. In an announcement video today, Booker nods to that history. His parents' struggle to buy a home in a white, affluent neighborhood, and a white lawyer who helped them to do so because he was inspired by Martin Luther King and the civil rights movement. Booker says in his announcement video today that courage is contagious. It's part of the optimistic message he is hoping to bring to this presidential primary. I want you to take a look at his announcement video.
Together, we will channel our common pain back into our common purpose. Together, America, we will rise. I'm Cory Booker, and I'm running for president of the United States of America.
So today, Cory Booker answering one question, will he run for president? And the next question, how will he fare in this crowded Democratic primary, one of the most diverse in history, if not the most diverse in history? One advantage he could have is that he has raw political talent the Democrats point to. One of the challenges, this is a year of the woman, women candidates running. He's going to go on The View today for his first interview after he rolls out his campaign, and then off to Iowa, South Carolina, and New Hampshire in the weeks to come.
Rebecca Buck for us in New Jersey. Cory Booker announces he's running for president, certainly one of the more anticipated announcements in this 2020 race. Let's bring in CNN senior political reporter Nia Malika Henderson, Van Jones, host of The Van Jones Show, Jackie Kucinich, Washington bureau chief for The Daily Beast, and John Avlon here as well. Van, I want to start with you here. Where does Cory Booker fit in this new crowded field? And I don't think it's any coincidence at all that Senator Booker's announcing on February 1st, the beginning of Black History Month, and some of his first radio interviews will be with the likes of Tom Joyner, an extremely, maybe the most popular African-American radio host.
Well, Tom Joyner, certainly that. First of all, I have to say I've known Cory Booker for almost 25 years. I graduated from Yale Law School in spring of 93. He showed up in the fall of 93 and took the entire law school over. I'm so glad I got out before the Cory Booker phenomenon took over Yale Law School. You have Bill Clinton and you have Cory Booker, the two people that had the biggest impact on that law school, just his raw political talents. He's a force to be reckoned with. Cory Booker is a force of nature. No one's surprised that he's running, because in some ways people have been telling him to run since he's a very small guy. Don't forget, this guy left Yale Law School, could have gone anywhere in the world, went to Newark, New Jersey, moved basically into the poorest neighborhood, and began the most improbable climb from, you know, working with folks in housing projects, living in a housing project, to now running for president of the United States. He is not a normal person. He's not a normal candidate. He's somebody who brings an extra gear when it comes to energy and empathy, and you're going to see that through the rest of his campaign.
Yeah, I heard you in the background there. As we heard, he's not a normal candidate, being described as well by Van there as a force of nature. What's your take? Where does he fit in now in this increasingly crowded field?
Yeah, I think Van hits on great points there. The energy, the enthusiasm, you can see it there in that introductory video. He's got the marching band there. It feels very young. It feels very now. It feels very fresh. Cory Booker is somebody who people have known about for years. If you go back to 2002, there was a New York Times magazine article that said he would likely be the first Black president. That was in 2002. He, of course, now is trying to be the second Black president. I think his path looks a lot like Obama's. And in many many ways Kamala Harris's does too, this idea that you can do well with not only African-American voters, but Latino voters as well, young voters, as well as women. I mean, these are people who are occupying the same lane in many ways, and it's not just because they're both African-American. It's because they're fresh faces. It's because they've already sort of zeroed in on key constituencies and already have some sway with those constituencies. The interesting thing about Booker is that he was doing a lot of the things that we see Beto O'Rourke doing now, the things that we see AOC doing now as well. Heavy on Twitter, heavy on Instagram, heavy on that social media, and really energizing young folks. And we'll see if he can keep that kind of spirit alive in this campaign, because he has been around so long, if he can keep that freshness going forward in this race.
He's been around. His social media game, too, we should point out, has actually been around for a long time.
And
he was early on.
It was actually practically before social media, right? I mean, Cory Booker predates the social media game and then actually helped usher it in. Jackie, Rebecca Buck noted this is easily the most diverse candidate field we've ever seen. We can put up the pictures here so people can see of the people who've already announced in or are exploring. You have five women. You have, you know, a Latino in Julian Castro. You have Mayor Pete Buttigieg, who is gay. This is a very, very diverse field already.
Well, absolutely. And that's why we're talking a lot about lanes, right? Because we're going to have a lot of these candidates competing for the same people. You talk about Kamala Harris and Cory Booker. There's been reporting they've already been courting various members of the Black caucus in the House. You know, one of the things, though, Cory Booker has made criminal justice reform a part of his being, right? I mean, he just helped push it through the Senate. Kamala Harris is going, that's going to be a big point of contention between the two of them because of her role as a prosecutor, as the AG when she was in California. I think we're going to hear a lot of exchanges between the two of them as we get a little further into this about that issue in particular, because that's going to be one of the ways they try to really separate themselves from in the lane that they're both in.
There's been a lot of talk about taking certain voting blocks, certain demographics for granted, as we know, over the last number of years. And John Avalon, one of the things that stood out to me, we were talking to Michael Smirkanish just a short time ago and asking him what his listeners were saying about this growing field. And he was saying that people were calling in and saying, listen, I'm a minority caller, and I want you to know Kamala Harris should not be taking my vote for granted just because of who I am. And that's an important reminder, too, is we're seeing the courting is important, but let's not forget people are people, and they want more. They don't want just a one-dimensional candidate.
Of course, and I think it's time as a country we have this incredibly diverse field where, you know, of the folks already running, you know, the straight white guys are I think there's one candidate right now. And that speaks to the evolution of American politics and the Democratic Party. But it also speaks to, I think, the need to transcend our tribalism, and the ethnic and racial algebra of putting together coalitions doesn't work as so much as being a compelling candidate with a great message and a great record. And with Cory Booker, as you heard, you know, Van say, this is someone who's been laid with great expectations from early on. I mean, people running for city council in Newark don't typically get New York Times profiles. They don't get an award-winning documentary Street Fight about their first mayoral race.
Non-successful.
Yes, non-successful. Right. It's a great talk. And so, you know, you get a sense of that trajectory. And his record, he has executive experience. That's an important differentiator. It's actually, we've got more mayors in the race right now, current and ex-mayors, than governors. And he has a strong record, brought a lot of attention and investment into Newark, lowered unemployment, lowered crime. But there was the criticism from his successor, then a city councilman, that you see the mayor more on Meet the Press than in the streets towards the end of his term. And so that's one of the things. He's been a media figurehead for so long. Can he keep that freshness and that energy? But he is a raw talent that really stands out in any political
I actually think he backed off a lot of the media over the last four or 5 years in anticipation, I think, of getting in this race. And Van, you've been talking about, we were having this discussion about taking no one's votes for granted. I've heard you say that many times here. No one should assume that any one voter or voting bloc is going to follow any one candidate for any one reason. Cory Booker, complicated, interesting, as you said. He also, if he's been criticized for something, it's for being too close to Wall Street, right? He is a senator from New Jersey. This is an interesting year to be running with Elizabeth Warren and others very critical of Wall Street. Cory Booker is someone who has been seen to be close to financial interests.
I think one of the reasons why, in addition to his personal passion for the issue, that he's leaned so hard on criminal justice reform is because it is, a very, very strong progressive value that rounds out the picture of Cory Booker. Cory Booker really was that guy who would, in the morning, he might be in a community center in Newark talking to the poorest kids in New Jersey. And then that afternoon, he might be on Wall Street talking to the some of the richest people in the world, and then back in Newark, and basically with the same message to both constituents. But if you just grab him on the Wall Street side, you can really do some damage to him with this new Democratic Party that does not like Wall Street, that really was born with Occupy Wall Street, saying the 99% versus the 1%. Cory Booker can sometimes be characterized as being too close to that so-called 1%. This may not be the year for that. So you're going to see him go very hard with the black community, going to go very hard on criminal justice reform, going to go very hard on his kind of common touch, which he does have with ordinary people. But he is going to catch fire, and he's going to catch some flack from the left of our party.